holidays.
Thank you.
My mice deserve a holiday as much as we do.
They smell, for one thing.
But I always take my mice to Walsingby.
Not this year.
Morning.
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 Good morning, William.
Good morning, dear. You're looking very bright and breezy.
Keeping up with college traditions, I see.
The traditions?
Cold baths before breakfast.
But you hate baths, William.
Wakes up the old brain cells.
Especially cold ones.
Oh, will someone please remind me to ask Mrs. Lambert to bring down your father's bath? Well, at least the sun is shining on our journey.
If my mice can't go, then I'm not going either.
Oh, now you're really being silly.
They'll pine away without me, and they might even die.
I'm not at all sure mice are capable of pining, Robert.
Yes, they are.
But, Robert, there's hardly enough room in the broom for all of us, let alone for 8 white mice.
But they came last year and the year before.
You and Ellen were smaller then. Growing up means learning to make sacrifices. Thank you, Mrs. Lambert. Will?
William, call into my study after breakfast, would you? I'd like a word.
But we're all ready to leave, dear.
Won't take long. Come in, William. Oh, sit down, make yourself comfortable. Heard you swinging the dumbbells this morning. Getting in training?
10 swings, night and morning.
Oh.
But when I graduated...
Ah, Cambridge. Punting on the backs, long summer holidays. Illness is no respecter for doctor's holidays, as you'll soon discover. Always on call.
Still, you always enjoy Walsingby, don't you, Father?
Oh, yes. Now, I was looking through my security box last night, and I came across this. I thought you might like to take a look at it.
What is it?
It's a deed. Deed of partnership.
Between William Henchman, surgeon and apothecary of Rushby, and Edmund Henchman of the same place. Oh, I see. Partnership between your father and grandfather.
Yes, that's it.
In which the said William, in consideration of the natural love and affection which he beareth for the said Edmund, agrees to take him into partnership. They agree to share the expenses of the horses, their stabling and their food, the apprentices, drugs, fuel, and candles. This is so old-fashioned.
Yes, well, we can always leave out the bit about apprentices in ours. I'm very proud of you, William.
Thank you, Father.
You'll be a great credit to the family practice, I know.
We'd have to change the candles to oil lamps, too.
Yes.
Still, dear.
But I ache all over.
growing pains.
I do believe I can smell the sea.
We must be nearly there.
I wonder if Etty will help pick the apples like she did last year.
Etty?
You must remember Etty, Father.
You know, dear, that big girl who helps Mrs. Ransom.
Oh, yes.
Mrs. Ransom made apple pie afterwards.
Mm. Yum, yum.
Forgotten Etty'd be there.
She's almost a young woman.
But she's such fun.
Oh. Come on, Rob.
Hooray! We're here!
Oh.
Where's Bessie? Is she in the same sty?
Yes, of course she is. Off you go.
Come on, Ellen.
Hello, Mrs. Ransom.
Hello, my dear. Oh, don't you do that on your own, Dr. Henchman. I'll get you some help. Jim, come and give them a hand to unload.
Etty'll help, Father. She's very strong.
Never mind about the hens. You can do them later. Hello, Mrs. Henchman. Dr. Henchman, nice to see you. Get the bath down, Jim.
Oh, no, you have got Percy, if you would. Thank you, William.
Hello? Mother?
Oh, thanks. Bessie's had piglets.
After your long journey.
Mrs. Ransom, where's Etty?
Oh, don't worry about your boxes, Mrs. Henchman. Jim will see they come to no harm.
But Mrs. Ransom...
Not just now, dear. I'm busy installing your mother.
Installing mother? It sounds like a battleship entering harbour.
I see your father's gone off already.
And I don't know where William is.
Thank you, Mrs. Ransom.
Rob, you're not in a sty now.
Oh, never mind him, Ellen.
May I have a go on the donkey, please?
Of course you can.
Coming, Ellen.
No.
Mind he doesn't throw you.
Boys will be boys.
Have another scone.
No, thank you. I get growing pains. Mrs. Ransom, where's Etty?
Etty Ling. Well, she's not coming anymore.
Why?
Because I don't want her, that's why.
But why don't you want her? We're far too much for you to cope with on your own. And she's a treasure. You said so yourself.
Well, she's gone away, if you must know. She's gone to her mother's folk, up north.
William?
Hmm?
William, I... Nothing. Has Mr. Ransom said anything to you about Etty?
Who?
Etty Ling.
You know, she helps Mrs. Ransom in the house. Or she did.
Oh, yes.
Well, she's not here anymore.
So?
But she's my friend.
You all ready for the Sandman, Ellen? Have you had a nice day?
I suppose so. I miss Etty.
Do you, dear? Well, never mind. You'll soon make new friends, more your own age.
But why should I? Etty's my friend.
But she's only a ploughman's daughter. You'd soon have tired of her anyway. Simple country girl like that. She doesn't read books like we do. In fact, she hasn't a thought in her head beyond the farm and this village. Now, I think it was high time your friendship did come to an end.
What's happened to her, Mother?
And her accent's dreadful. Absolutely dreadful.
I like it.
Oh, really, Ellen?
Do you know what's happened to her?
No, I don't. And I don't propose to ask, either.
But why?
Because, Ellen, dear, it's none of my business. Cheer up. There's the whole of the holidays ahead of you. Good night, dear.
She's gone away.
It's none of my business.
She's gone away.
Make new friends, more your own age.
Etty! It's not fair! You're older than me. You can run faster.
She's gone away.
It's none of my business.
She's gone away. She's gone away.
Wonderful. Don't you want to fly the kite?
Have you any idea what's happened to Etty?
No.
Both Mother and Mrs. Ransom say she's gone away, but I know it isn't true. Anyway, nobody ever leaves Walsingby.
No, they don't, do they? I was reading about India the other day. They need doctors there.
She's here, somewhere. I know she is.
But Father needs me.
Father's really enjoyed the last few days, mooching around the rock pools and fields, looking for his insects and so on.
Makes a change from being on call the whole time.
Yes. Father will be glad when you're qualified and can help him.
Yes. Poor Father. I'd hate to let him down, wouldn't you?
Of course I would. I nearly drowned here once when I was little.
There must have been an accident.
But he's on holiday.
See? He needs me. Father?
Jim's gone to get my bag. They're sending the trap for us.
What's happened?
Weston.
Weston? You mean the Mr. Weston you play chess with?
That's right.
Has he had an accident?
He's climbed up on the roof of his house. He's throwing slates down and threatening to kill himself.
What?
Yes, I know. Everything to live for and... Yet every 2 or 3 years, something seems to snap inside him and he gets the urge to do away with himself. Poor man.
We were having such a nice day. I wonder what it is. Probably somebody making a fuss about nothing. Poor Father.
Don't worry, Mrs. Weston.
I can't do anything with him. I begged him and begged him to come down.
He seems to be quiet at the moment. Ladders. Tell me how it all started.
I should have known. I should have realized. It was all the rain we had. Raining and raining it was. With all the hay rotting in the fields. He said it was God's judgment on him for being a wicked man. He said the rain was a punishment. And I got angry. I know I shouldn't have, but it seemed so daft. I mean, he's a good man. I told him, you're a good man, a good husband and a good father. I mean, it rained on the people in the next village too, and they're not wicked. And what about Sodom and Gomorrah? I mean, it never rained there at all. I mean, rain's got nothing to do with it.
How did you get up there?
From the attic. There's a small dormer behind the chimney. You can't go in after him. He's locked the door.
What was he doing in the attic?
One of his problems.
Ah. Problems? Chess.
Your father gave him a book of chess problems to take his mind off things when he gets low. Often does the trick. Didn't this time, though, he couldn't solve it.
What was it? Did he say?
No. He kept muttering on about somebody's gambit, whatever that means.
No! Get away from here! The lot of you! Go on, get away from here! God has put a curse on me! Nothing goes right! Keep away!
James! Stop for a minute. Please stop. I'm coming up.
You're not coming on my rope.
Get out of the way quickly. Father, watch out!
Ah!
Father, wait. I'll go. Thank you, William. But James knows me.
Yes, but...
Ah!
It's dangerous, and I'm younger than you. He's mad.
He's my patient, William. My patient and my friend.
Etty!
Morning, Mrs. Lee.
What do you want?
I came to see Etty.
Well, Etty isn't seeing you, and that's flat.
But why not?
It's no business of yours, Miss Ellen. Now be off with you, and don't come here again. Do you hear me?
Then, after white castles, black moves pawn to queens, bishops, fourth. I think it's the best he can do. Though, of course, chamber stock does offer another solution. He suggests moving bishop to queen's third and check. Dangerous.
Uncovers his own king, doesn't it?
Exactly. Besides, when it comes down to it, I don't think there's much strength to the attack. Do you?
Why is that?
Well, it's all bluff. But much better to move pawn to Queen's Bishop's Court. I suggested it in the first place. At least it's a real move.
I don't follow.
Why? Well, protects his knight and opens up a path for his rook.
Come and play.
Leave me alone.
You're no fun anymore.
I miss Etty.
I miss my white mice, but I don't keep going on about it.
Ellen. You look a little flushed, dear.
That's nice.
Why don't you go upstairs and lie down for a while,
And this is the really brilliant stroke, James. White moves queen to queen's rook's board.
What does black do to counter that?
It's so difficult playing blind. It's so much easier when it's all laid out on a chessboard.
Show me.
They're coming down. Thanks to your father. God bless him.
It's far too easy to find yourself edging.
Please, they're off the roof.
No, I stand by my first.
Doctor?
Is that you, Mrs. Weston?
Yes, Doctor, me and William. May we come in?
Of course you can. Just as soon as we finish this chess problem. Meanwhile, perhaps you get James a cup of tea.
Certainly I will. Right this minute, Doctor.
Bring one a cup while you're at it.
And William?
Yes, Father?
Fetch Mr. Weston's dressing gown.
I'll get the dressing gown.
I said I wanted a dressing gown.
No, but you do want one, don't you?
Why?
It's simply that you're cold, James.
I am not cold. I'm not! That's a downright lie.
Nonsense, James. You're shivering.
I am not!
Look at your hands, my dear friend.
I am not cold! I'm not cold.
I've brought the dressing gown, Doctor.
I'll go down and have some tea then now.
Now, I wonder when that tea's coming. Ah, come in, William.
Here. It's a lot colder out than you might think today. Feel my hand.
Yes. So, this is your son, is it? Following in your father's footsteps, are you?
And Still, the nursing home should do him good.
I was quite frightened there for a while.
Yes. I suppose it's the unpredictability of madness that's frightening. You never know what's going to happen. Still, life's like that. Stop for a moment, would you? Ah, such beauty. What a world. It would be a pity to miss any of it. Do you know how old my father was when he signed that deed of partnership?
No.
32. He'd studied in Paris and Leiden. He'd done research in a London hospital. He'd really seen something of life. And that's what I want for you too, William. And if at the end of it all, you find that research suits you better than being a country doctor like me, then that's what you must do. No man should be bound by his forebears. You need never sign that deed.
I'll think about it, Father. I'll think about it.
Well, that ends well. And William was marvellous. I don't know what I'd have done without him.
Sit down. I'll have Mrs. Ransom bring you something to eat.
Father!
In bed?
She was a little flushed, that's all. Nothing for you to worry about.
How is Mr. Weston?
Fine. What about you? What's wrong? Growing pains again? What is it then? Tell Papa. Aren't you enjoying a holiday?
Yes. But I'd be enjoying it a lot more if Etty were here.
Ah.
What's happened to her, Father?
Probably just some silly woman's quarrel. You know what they're like.
Yes.
I expect Mrs. Ransom's fallen out with Mrs. Ling, that's all. And poor Etty's in the middle of it.
Yes. But what would they quarrel about?
Now, how should I know?
Couldn't you find out?
Well, I doubt if they'd tell me anything, Ellen. We keep ourselves to ourselves in this part of the world, you know that.
But you're a doctor. They'd tell you.
Doctors don't go poking their noses in where they don't belong, do they? I'm going to get something to eat.
Don't close the door, Father.
Do you want any tea? Get some rest then.
Says the nursing home's doing him a lot of good.
Poor Mrs. Weston. She must be very relieved.
Where's Father?
He was called out last night. He's not back yet, I'm afraid.
Can't I leave Father alone for 1 month of the year?
That's a doctor's life for you.
Oh, isn't that nice? Colonel and Mrs. Stacy Cunningham want us to visit them at Eastwold Hall this Friday. Don't worry. You're not invited. Only your father and I.
Cara! Cara! Oh, Cara, it's so cruel. How can people be so hard-hearted?
Shh. The children are in the morning room. Come outside.
What's wrong with Father?
Oh, I expect he's worried about one of his patients.
But who? Who's been cruel? Poor Father. And he'll hate going to the Stacy Cunninghams. You have to dress up to go there.
Exactly. Mother will like it.
Huh. William,
If Mother and Father are out this Friday, will you help me with the pig pen?
The pig pen? Why?
Mr. Ransom wants it swilled out.
And he's asked you to help him?
Yes. He can't do everything. And Jim's busy with the mowing.
Well, I might go on an expedition for the day. Not spoil Mother's Day, eh, Rob? Goodness, Ellen, what a crybaby you are.
Poor Father, having to dress up, and it's so hot.
Mother looked nice, didn't she?
May I go and help Mr. Ransom with the pigs now?
I expect so. Well, what shall we do, Ellen? I'm sure she did.
And now she's gone. Disappeared.
I don't know why we're rushing. She obviously doesn't want to see us.
It. There she is! Etty! Etty?
I've lost it.
What? What have you lost?
The baby.
What do you mean lost? Is it dead?
No, it's fine. It's beautiful. It's just that I can't find it. I put it down here, somewhere. And now... No!
You mean you put it down and now it's gone? Maybe your mother came for it.
No!
Etty. Etty, listen to me. Come on. It's all right. Be calm. Just tell me all about it.
Well, I brought the baby down to the shore this morning. Then I remembered something I'd left at home. You see, it's nice on the beach. The baby seemed to like it. So I made a little nest for it in the sand. To keep it out of the wind. And I laid it down all cozy like. And then I left it.
And now you can't find the place again, is that it?
Don't cry, Etty. William and I will help you. We're bound to find it soon. Please don't cry.
Yes, it's easily done, Etty. One sandy hollow looks much like another.
Poor thing. Your mother will be so cross with you for losing her baby. I know just how you feel.
Come along, Ellen. You go that way. I'll go this way with Etty. Come along now.
wearing?
She was wrapped in a red flannel petticoat.
The tide's going out, Etty. It can't have been washed out to sea.
We'd better go back to the farm. Get help.
No, please don't do that.
But we must, Etty. We've got to raise the alarm.
For a minute. She was coming back.
I wasn't to know.
You can't just pick up babies and take them home with you. It's wrong.
Hello, Etty.
Ellen, will you come inside with me for a moment and help me with my things?
Come on, Rob. I hope you've not been giving the piglets cold cake. I was going to call on you this evening. We came back by your aunt's house. She was telling me that when you were a little girl.
We had such a lovely day, Ellen.
Did you?
You know, I think next time you might come with us. You're almost old enough. Ellen? Dear?
So, my Aunt Alma's gonna take us. What, both of us?
Yes. She said she'd be glad to have you.
What? To stay?
That's right.
Ellen? Have you heard a word of what I've been saying?
Etty's had a baby.
She'll give you both a good home. I know she will. I am glad, Etty.
My Aunt Alma was always a good one, bless her.
There now, we've got a home, my pet. Well, looky, we are, really.
Etty tried to abandon her baby, didn't she?
She came back for it. That's the important thing. She loves it, Ellen. You could see that.
I know.
And Father's found them both a good home.
You're very like him, you know.
Father. I expect I'll go into practice with him one day. When I finish travelling about and so on.
That's nice.
So you see, it's not the end of the world.
No. It's not the end of the world.
Enjoyed that. This, by the way, is my last children's BBC of the 1980s, but we're back on January the 2nd. Just before I go, a broom cover thanks to Hayden Sutherland, who is 8, lives in Potters Purie in North Hants, for the window picture. Wilson's bought you a Christmas present, Ed. Oh, isn't that nice of him? Oh, go on and open it up. Let's have a see what you bought him. What have you bought him, Wils? What's he got? Ooh. Stuffing. Oh. Never mind. Look, I've got you one. I bought you a present as well. Look. You see what I bought you? Look. I bought you clothes pegs. What are these for? Let me show you. Look, there. That's what the clothes pegs are for. Ah, a great improvement. Oh, no. Ed's bought us a present. Well, let me take that off, then. We'll take that off. I'm sorry, mate. I really apologise. Northern Ireland, have a very nice Christmas and a Happy New Year. See you next year. Bye. Well, we were only joking. We were only joking, weren't we? Just open it. Oh, all right, then. I don't know what it is. I wonder what it is. You are joking. It's a very large photograph of Ed the Duck. What you like. Listen, have a really nice Christmas and a very, very happy New Year. I will see you in 1990. Children's BBC Two, 7 o'clock Sunday morning, going live with Phil and Sarah tomorrow morning at 9. And Simon, Andy and Lisa will look after you right over Christmas. See you next year. Bye.
Ho, ho, ho. At this festive time of the year, to help us celebrate, we have somebody suitably special in the small but manly shape of that well-loved comic actor, singer, writer, and composer, wine bibber, beer drinker. Yes. Dudley Moore. All the way from Hollywood, be helping us celebrate here on Friday. See you at 7.
See you at 7.
Thank you.
Now, here on BBC One, all the way from Ramsey Street, it's them neighbours.
Neighbours, everybody needs good neighbours with a little understanding. You can find the perfect blend. Neighbours should be there for one another. That's when good neighbors become good friends.
You've done well, Mum. He's not sneezing.
What? Oh, you never mind about that. Look at Mum. Look.
Hey, you've got a rash.
Yeah, very itchy, too. Almost the same as when I was bitten by a flea as a child.
Fleas, you say?
Yeah, very nasty business it was, too.
What are you thinking, Henry?
Well, I could be wrong, but it's just occurred to me that the invisible mosquito plague might only be a flea plague.
It better not be.
Fleas?
Rats, what are you doing?
It's a flea! The carpet's full of fleas!
Those wretched cats! Oh.
Well, it can't have been the kittens. They were around a long time before the scratching started, but... But the carpet wasn't. And the kittens were on the carpet, so when Bronwyn took them home, they must have spread them to the mangle house.
No wonder Joe Mangle sold your carpet cheap. Honestly, Henry.
I'm sorry.
That's not good enough.
How about very sorry?
No. You are responsible for those fleas. Now, either you fix them or I'll fix you.
Oh, thank you, Bronwyn. I must say, shopping with your sister is quite an exhausting experience.
Well, she didn't get much of a chance to window shop in Narrabri.
You have to do the rounds here to get what you really want.
Certainly did Jamie good. He was already asleep when I got him back to Des.
Oh, half his luck. That dripping tap in there kept me awake half the night. Wasn't Joe supposed to be coming round today to fix it up, Mrs. Mangle?
Yes, he should be here any minute.
Hi.
I didn't hear you knock.
No. Sorry, it's kind of urgent.
Oh, what's the excuse for calling around this time, Henry?
Oh, does someone else want a kitten?
No, but they're sort of connected to what's happening.
Well, for goodness sake, get to the point and tell us what is happening.
It's nothing to panic about. We've got a flea plague at our place.
A flea plague? How dare you come into this house? You're probably covered with the beastly things. Take yourself off at once, young man.
It's not that simple.
When did the kittens come into it?
Well, I was minding and they would have picked up the fleas and brought them over here.
Them in my house? I knew I should never have allowed you to bring those wretched...